Alright, now the infrastructure as a code, or IAC. Well, actually, I got this from the Wikipedia. Now, as you can see, it is the process of managing and provisioning computer data centers through machine-readable definition files. So, rather than physical hardware configuration or interactive configuration tools, so you are defining and implementing all of your infrastructure within a code. So, you write the code and then you run it. And that code is responsible to build your infrastructure. So this is why it is called infrastructure as a code or IAC. Okay, now if you scroll down, you can see that there are a lot of tools for the infrastructure as a code, like the Shiv, the Puppet, Otter, SaltStack, CF Engine, Terraform, and actually Terraform is very popular. And you can see Ansible Tor, and there are other tools like the AWS CloudFormation, which is our subject here. Okay, now actually regarding the popularity, I think Terraform is more popular than AWS CloudFormation. Actually, it's not like it's better or something like that, no, but the thing is, because Terraform has this feature or has this something called the cloud agnostics or multi-cloud provider, so you have specific services from AWS, for example, and another services from Google Cloud and other services on Azure, or just Google Cloud and Azure, or Google Cloud and AWS, and so on, so that we can have or build our infrastructure on all of these cloud providers with just simple code. Okay, but actually that doesn't make CloudFormation is less than or less powerful. Well, actually CloudFormation is very powerful and widely used. So the thing is, if you have all of your services and servers running on AWS, so CloudFormation comes more handy and more powerful, because everything you are using is on AWS. So why not to use AWS CloudFormation? And each new features, each new functionality, each new services on AWS, it will be updated immediately on CloudFormation. But on the other hand, the Terraform, it will take time until they make update and blah, 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 and so on. All right? But you may ask me, who may use AWS itself or just AWS? Well, actually, there are a lot of use cases. A lot of companies just use AWS. They didn't use Google Cloud or Azure. Like, for example, Netflix. Netflix is a very popular company that use all of their services just using AWS. It doesn't use any other cloud providers. So in that case, building your own infrastructure using CloudFormation is more powerful and has its own pros rather than using other tools like Terraform, for example. All right. Now, in the next lecture, we will handle the CloudFormation. We will have a quick overview and see the structures, the syntax, and how it works, and so on. All right. So, I will see you there. All right. Now, AWS CloudFormation. Now, as I told you, the CloudFormation is infrastructure as a code tool. It gives you an easy way to model a collection of related AWS and third-party resources, provisioning them quickly and consistently, and manage them throughout their lifecycle by treating infrastructure as a code. So you provide the code or the infrastructure as a code, then you will provision all the resources and build the infrastructure you want, just with a few clicks, or even you can automate that using CLI, API, and so on. All right. So as you can see, you can use a template to create, update, or delete entire stack as a single unit as often as you need to. Now, you may ask me, what is template? What is stack? What all of that? I don't know anything about it. Don't worry, we will talk about these in detail. Okay, but for now, let's have some of the benefits. So as you can see, it automates best practices. So for a DevOps engineer, actually, the automation is a very crucial thing. So you need, this is some of the best practices to automate everything, even though your infrastructure. So your infrastructure is deleted. You don't need to worry about it. You can just few clicks and have all of your infrastructure up and running. Or if you need to copy all your infrastructure to another region, for example, you don't need to have all the weekend or have a whole week just deploying the infrastructure on that region. You just click, right click in a few seconds and you have them there. Well, actually not a few seconds. Depends on how large your infrastructure and so on. Okay, there are a lot of factors in fact. Okay, now you can scale your infrastructure worldwide. You can integrate with other AWS services, as you can see with like AWS IAM for access control, AWS config for compliance, and AWS service catalog for trunky application distribution and additional governance. Now we can manage a third party and private resources, as well as extend CloudFormation with the community. So how it works? Now, this is the most important thing. Now, here, as you can see, this is the diagram, and I intended actually to give you that from the official documentation. So you need to get used of using AWS official documentation. Anything you wanted, this is your guide. Just go there and search it, or Google it, or search any using any search engine. But it is better to use or to get the information from their official documentation. All right. Now, as you can see, first the code infrastructure. So you type your code infrastructure from scratch, you write it, and this is something called a template actually. So using any language, so either YAML language or JSON format. All right. Now, in this course, we will handle YAML, which is yet another markup language actually, because it is very simple. It's not complicated, and it is human readable actually. So you can write, read anything. It's very easy to read and write programs. Okay, so you write your template, and this is what we talked about, which is the template. The template is your code written in a YAML or JSON format, and then you will upload it to an S3 bucket. So as you can see, you upload it to S3 bucket, or you can put it locally. Now, everything here is from the console, all right? So you don't worry about doing that manually, all right? So you, from the console, few clicks and you have everything. Then AWS CloudFormation, as you can see, use via the browser console or command line tools or API to create the stack based on your template code. Now you may ask me, what is the stack? Well, actually the stack is collection of the AWS resources that you have implemented in the code. So you write in the code you want to deploy EC2 instances or RDS databases or DynamoDB or security group, EIP, whatever, okay, load balancer and so on. So all of these resources will be inside something called stack, and this stack, you can create more stack like that, you can put nested stacks, you can delete it, you can edit it, you can modify it. Even if there is something called drift detection, don't worry, we will handle that in this course, in this section precisely. So all of that resources will be in this stack. All right, then the output, as you can see, AWS CloudFormation provisions and configures the stacks and resources you specified on your template. So finally, you will have an infrastructure, EC2, security group, load balancer, and so on. Here are some of the featured customers. As you can see, Coinbase, Expedia. As you can see, Expedia use AWS CloudFormation with Chef to deploy its entire front and back end stack into its AWS environment. Now you can read more about that. Actually, there are a lot of blogs, a lot of articles. If you want to read about it, I recommend you to do that. Here some of the features, like the extensibility, cross account and cross region management, which is something we talked about and very important. Authoring with JSON YAML, authoring with familiar programming language if you are using CDK, which is the Cloud Development Kit. Build serverless application with SAM, safety controls, preview change to your environment, dependency management. All right. Now, one of the cool features from AWS CloudFormation, actually, it is free. You don't pay anything. As you can see, there is no additional charge for using AWS CloudFormation with resources provided in the following namespace. As you can see, in this case, you can pay for AWS resources only. So you pay for the underlying resources. So as you can see, you only pay for what you use as you use it. There are no minimum fees and no required upfront. So you don't pay anything for using CloudFormation. You just pay for the resources. So if you deploy or if you provision EC2 instances, you pay for that or for those EC2 instances. That's it. And you don't need to pay or you don't pay anything for using CloudFormation, which is something very cool. And well, it is from AWS within, so it is good. You can read, there are some of the examples here if you are interested. Well, actually, I recommend you to do that. Okay, now let's have a real quick from the console. So as you can see from here, you go to the CloudFormation, and from here you can see that we have stacks, stack sets, explore designer. Here you can create the stack. You can see how much stacks I have, and this is the main page, how it works. There are some of the benefits and more. Okay, now don't worry, we will handle all of these and all the important things, and I will try my best as much as I can to give you everything important for you as a developer or as a DevOps engineer. Okay, so keep with me, work with me step by step, and you will learn a lot. All right, I will see you in the next lecture. All right, now this lecture actually is give you a very brief quick view for the YAML syntax, so you will come to understand the basics of using YAML and how it works. So actually, YAML is a key value pairs. As you can see, type and the value of type. This is some examples. So the first thing, it starts with three dashes, as you can see. Then on the same level, as you can see, we can have resources. And for the resources, as you can see here, there are two spaces. If you notice here, there are two spaces. This means that my instance here is inside the resources, all right? Inside the resources tree. Okay, so here, as you can see, the type, there are two more spaces, as you can see. So which means that the my instance here, inside it, there are something called type. And the type here is AWS EC2 instance, whatever, this is some value. We will talk about these in details when time comes. But for now, as you can see, it is a key value pair, all right? And the type here, which is inside the my instance, that inside resources, as you can see. Now the same thing for properties. The properties is for the my instance, as you can see, two spaces here. As you can see, the properties for the my instance. So my instance here have type of this value, whatever, and have these properties. And these properties, they are inside the properties. As you can see, there are two spaces here for each one, the availability zones, the image ID, the instance type, and so on. So the instance type, the image ID, the availability zone, these are properties of my instance that are inside the resources. Okay, now let's have another example, which is this one. As you can see, this is a bigger example. We started with three dashes as well. The parameters here, whatever. We used security group, which is inside the parameter tree. And we have this description for this security group description. As you can see, this is the description, and the type here is for the security group. As you can see, the type here is not for the description here. The type here is for the security group description. As you can see, there are two spaces here. Okay, so actually it's the YAML is very easy to read, very easy to use and to write. And here, as you can see, the resources. So if you notice, we don't have spaces here, which means that the resources here is a complete or a whole new tree. So for the parameter has the security group inside it and inside the security group description and type. Now new thing called resources inside it, my instance, and inside the my instance type and properties, and these inside the properties. And as you can see here, the security group, we inside it, there are list. As you can see, there are dash. This means that there, this is a list of this value, and we will talk about this, don't worry, the ref function, intrinsic functions, we don't worry about that. And here is you can put the comment as well, it doesn't matter. And if you notice here, as you can see, this is the first resource we have, and this is the second resource. So if you notice, there are two spaces here, the my EIB. There are two spaces, which means that my EIB is inside the resources as well. And this is the same for the SSH security group, the server security group, and so on. All right. So from its structure, it is very simple. It is very easy to use. It's very easy to read. And you can write it right away. You can write a lot of YAML now after you see that. As you can see, it's very easy and very simple. Just a key value pair. And these were inside the tree, okay? Now depends on the spaces we have. So as I told you, all right. I will see you in the next lecture where we will start creating our stacks. And we need before that, creating the resources we want. And as you can see, here is are some of the resources we will create, like the security group, like the instances, EIP, databases, and so on. All right, don't worry, we will take that step by step, slowly, so until you get it 100%. All right, but for now, we got the idea how to use the YAML, what is YAML, and how to use it, how to write programs or how to write scripts with it, and it is, you saw that it is very easy. It's not that complicated or hard. All right, I will see you there. The first thing, let's go to the CloudFormation console and let's create our first stack. So create stack, like as simple as that. You will find this template is ready, or you can use a sample template from here, from the list. Or you can create a template using the designer, as you can see. But for now, we have our template ready. And here you can either choose to upload them using S3. So you have your template already uploaded to S3. You can just provide the S3 URL here, or you can upload the template. And in my case, I will upload the template. And actually, regarding this template, which is the simple EC2 instance.yaml, you can find it. I already provide you with that if you need to practice with me. So I already provide you that as a downloadable content. You can find it there. Just download it and use it if you want, step by step. And don't worry, actually it is free. As you can see, this is a T2 micro, so it will not cost you any dime. And I recommend you to do that to practice with me. Alright, now let's choose the file, choose the template we want, and that's it. Alright, but before that, you can see that the image ID here, you need to provide it with the AMI you want. So in my case, I go to the instances from here, launch instance, and here I will use the Amazon Linux 2 AMI. As you can see, here are the AMI for 64-bit or 86, or you can have this AMI for the 64-bit ARM. Okay, in my case, I will use this AMI, as you can see. I will copy and paste it here. Okay, and by the way, you will find this file again as a downloadable content with this AMI. If this AMI is not working with you, you need to change it, as I told you. All right, now another thing I want to mention, that I am using the North Virginia region. So if you have a look on the YAML file, you can see that the availability zone here is US East 1A, and US East 1 is North Virginia. All right, so don't forget that. Okay, let's close this and let's upload it. Now here is the file, the simple EC2 instance. Then you can click on next. Here the stack name, let's name it test stack for now. Okay, next. Oh yeah, and here you can put any tags you want. For my case, I put name test stack for now. The permission, if you have a specific IAM role, for now we'll leave it as is. For the advanced options, we have the stack policy. Now here the stack policy, for now we leave it as is, but we can have no stack policy or enter a stack policy here as a JSON formatted text, or we can upload a file with a JSON formatted file for the stack policy. For now we leave it as no stack policy. Now here the rollback configuration. So as you can see, you can specify alarms for CloudFormation to monitor when creating or updating the stack. So you can monitor, as you can see, optional with 10 minute number of minutes after the operation completes. So after 10 minutes, it will go to alarm or whatever. Here the CloudWatch ARN, CloudWatch alarm ARN. Then you can see that we have a notification option. So if you want to send SNS topic, which is email or SMS to anyone, whatever. All right, for now we leave it as is. And here you can see that we have the stack creation options, which is rollback on failure. So if some failure happened, you can roll back, so you can enable or you can disable it. If you don't need to roll back, so you want to investigate why this happened or something like that, you don't need to roll back, you can just keep it as disabled. But for now I will leave it as enabled. And the timeout here, the number of minutes before the stack creation timeout. Okay, and the termination protection, if you want to prevent the stack from being accidentally deleted. Okay, I will leave it as disabled. So I will click on next. So here are the stack. You can see the estimate cost, but in our case, it will not cost us anything actually, because if you have a look here, you can see that this is an Amazon Linux 2 and with a T2 micro on North Virginia. All right. And this is the type of the something I am creating, or the resource we are creating. So which is the the instance or EC2 instance. All right. So another look, three dashes, the resources. The first one is name. Its name is my instance. Its type is AWS EC2 instance. And this means that this is an EC2 instance. And its name inside this template, is my instance. The type is EC2 instance, as I told you. And the properties is availability zone inside this availability zone. The image ID, this image ID, the instance type, which is this instance type. As simple as that. Actually, this is a simple EC2 instance. Now let's close from this. You can see the estimation. You can see the parameters. There are no parameters here. The tags, there are one tag I have created, as you can see. The permission, stack policy, the back notification, stack creation options, and so on. Okay. So here you can see that we have a quick create link. And you can use it, as you can see, a single page wizard to create stacks with the same basic configuration as this one. Okay, but for now, we don't need that. Now, let's create the stack. Now, as you can see, we have created the stack. So here are some of the stack information, like the stack ID, description. As you can see, the status is create in progress. If you scroll down, there are no IAM role, last drift check. Don't worry about the drift check. We will handle this in a separate lecture, actually. And this is something very useful. And the drift status, the tags, stack policy, rollback, configuration, notification, and so on. So for the events, as you can see, it is in here, the user initiated. As you can see, it is create in progress. Here, create in progress, but this is my instance, as you can see. Here, the create in progress with resource recreation initiated with my instance. If I refresh again, you can see that my instance here, create complete, the test stack, create complete. So everything is working fine. So if I go to the resources here, you can see that I have this resource, this EC2 instance. So again, if I go to the EC2 instance here, from here, and go to the running instances in the North Virginia region, you can see that I have this EC2 instance, with its name is test stack. And if I go to the tags, you can see that I have the tag that I already named, which is the test stack, by the way. Okay, but you can see that there are other tags, which is the AWS CloudFormation stack ID. As you can see, this is something generated by AWS. And we have the AWS CloudFormation stack name and the AWS CloudFormation, sorry about this, the logical ID, which is the my instance. As you can see, this is the logical ID in the template. If you have a look here, which is my instance here, this is the logical ID, all right, which is the one that we defined inside the template. All right, so let's go back. So here, these are the resources. The outputs here, there are no outputs because we didn't define any, but don't worry, we will have a separate section for that, or a separate lecture. The parameters, there are no parameters as well because we didn't define any, and again, we will have a separate lecture for that. Again, the template here, you can see that this is our template. As you can see, the resources in my instance, the instance type, and the instance type here. All right, and here the change set. Now there are no change set have been created or something, empty, as you can see. But again, we have a separate lecture for that. Don't worry about this. Now, one thing before we finish this lecture is the designer. So you can see that we can see our template here using the designer. So if I click on view in designer, you will see that I have my infrastructure here. So if I scroll down here, you can see that I have my instance here, which is the type is EC2 instance here, as you can see. And I can put any instance I want. As you can see, S3, access point, bucket policy, and so on. So you can just write your own infrastructure with a graphical user interface with a drag and drop functionality, as simple as that. But actually, to be honest, I don't prefer this method because it will not make you use the functionality of infrastructure as a code, as you can see, as a code. So you can't have your infrastructure written as a code. You will have it one by one. Well, actually, but on the other hand, you can put whatever resources here and finally generate the code, then use the code over and over with an automated way. Yeah, actually, everything, it depends on you. After all, what you prefer and what you want. But for me, I don't like that. Anyway, it's up to you after. Okay, now I will see you in the next lecture where we will update this stack and we will delete it. So I want to add more instances. For example, I want to add an elastic load balancer, elastic IP address. I want, for example, to attach elastic IP to this instance that already created. How to do that? We will learn that in the next lecture. All right, I will see you there. All right, now let's update our stack. Now we already created our first stack, which is creating a simple EC2. Now here, if you click on the stack, and you can see that we have this option, which is the update stack and delete. Delete, it will delete it as simple as that. But the update here, if you click on it, you can see that we can use current template, replace the current template, or edit template in designer. For now, we will replace the current template with upload a new template file from here. And actually, as you can see, EC2 with SG and EIP.yaml. Now here we will have EC2 instance with security group and the with elastic IP address will be attached to the EC2 instance. But remember, we already created our EC2 instance. So now we will create an elastic IP address and we will attach it to the instance and we will customize this instance with security group. Now we will see right away. But before that, let's have a look on the YAML file. You can see that the same format or syntax, but we added a parameters now. Now these parameters, as you can see, security group description, the description for the security group. And here we add the description. Here this is the description and the type is string, all right? The resource is the same thing. As you can see, the type is AWS EC2 instance. But by the way, the type of the resources actually is reserved. So you cannot put anything you want. You need to go to the documentation and you will have all the resources you want there. Or you can just open the designer, template designer, and put or take any resources you want from there. Actually, there are a lot of approaches. Okay, and the properties is the same. As you can see, the image ID here, the instance type is T2 micro, the security group. Now here, the thing is, as you can see, here there are two spaces. So these are for what? For the security groups. But here we use the ref function. Now this is something new actually, but we will have a separate lecture for it. But for now, these are called the intrinsic functions. And as you can see, the ref, which means references. So I reference the SSH security group. As you can see, the SSH security group from here. And the security group, which is the reference, security server security group, which is the other one. So if I go to the first one, which is the SSH security group, you can see that the type is AWS EC2 security group. And again, this is a reserved name, the type, I mean, these are AWS resources. So you cannot put anything here. You will choose the resources that they are existed, as well as they must have the right or the exact format. So AWS, as you can see, colon, colon, EC2, colon, colon, security group. And the properties is group description enable SSH 22. Actually, I got, as you can see, these templates, I got them from the official documentation from AWS. They provide you with a load library with templates for what you need, as well as you can modify depends on the application, the company, the policy you are working with, and so on. Depends on your criteria. The CIDR, I put anything and allow 22 from the port 22 to the port 22 using this IP protocol. Actually, I didn't memorize anything. I just copy and paste and use whatever I want, depends on the criteria I need. So as you can see, this is the first security group. The second security group is the same, as you can see, but this time we referenced the security group description, as you can see, for the type is EC2, but the properties, here we refer the group description. We didn't in hard code it like the above here. As you can see, we hard coded it, but here we referenced this from the security group description, which is the from the parameters. As you can see, the description in security group, and this must be entered or typed when we click next, and we will see right away after I click next, you can see that. But for now, keep with me. As you can see, the IP protocol is TCP from 80 to 80, the CIDR from anywhere, and the port 20, 22, 22, and the CIDR IP, which is this IP address only, okay? Now, actually, this is just a test. I want to show you as simple as that, okay? So this is the second security group. Now, finally, the elastic IP address. Now, again, don't forget that there are two spaces here, which means these are related to the resources. As you can see, my instance, two spaces, which means that my instance is inside the resources. And again, the my IP, there are two spaces here, which means that my IP is inside the resources. As you can see, we have a line here. If you are using a Sublime, I'm using Sublime currently, but you can use Visual Studio. Actually, it is very good as well. So here, the my IP, the type is AWS EC2 EIP. And again, this is a reserved name. You cannot put anything here for the type. And the properties is instance ID. And we want this elastic IP address to be attached to this instance, which is my instance, as you can see, which is this one. But you may ask me, how did I know about these? Well, actually, I didn't get to them from my house, let's say, or my home. These are from all the official documentation. I get them from there. They have their own format, their own syntax. You need to learn what is the syntax and how to use it. Okay, so far so good. All right, now let's see. Here we upload this thing. Yeah, by the way, another thing, I already upload that as a downloadable content, so you can find it there if you want to practice with me step by step. All right, and actually I recommend you to do that as well. Okay, now here I upload that as a template. We replace it with EC2 with SG and EIP. Let's click on next, and here you can see this is the something I talked about, which is the parameters. As you can see, this time the security group here, we need to provide the security group description, and this we saw that actually here. As you can see, we saw that when we create our instance and the security groups, one of them is the server security group, and the security group here, the one that we referenced, that use a reference to the security group description, which is something within the parameters, as you can see. So this parameter need to be entered or typed using a string type, as you can see. So I need to type any description here. So okay, so far so good, right? Now if I click next, you can see that we have all the tags we want. So like the name, these are from the previous stack, the first one we created, the same as permissions, stack policy, rollback configuration, notification options. So if you configured any of these, you will find it here. But because I didn't configure anything, you will not find anything here. Okay, so let's click on next. Here you can see that these are the parameters, the key, the permission, notification option, and so on. But what is important here actually is the change set preview. So you can see that we have four changes. The first thing is the add, which is we added my EIP, and the resource type is EC2 EIP, elastic IP address. So if I open this again, you can see that we added an elastic IP address, which is this one. As you can see, this is a new. All right. Now, the second thing is modify. The action is modify. So we modify the logical ID of my instance, which is this, my instance. This is the logical ID. We modify that to new instance. As you can see, the replacement is true here. Here is the type of the resource. The replacement is true. And this is the physical ID, not the logical ID, which means within the template. The physical ID, this is something already existed as a real life, or let's say that already deployed or already provisioned. Okay, but for the EIP, because we didn't create it yet, so no physical ID yet. Again, for the here we added a security group, as you can see, and we added another security group, server security group, and SSH security group. Okay, so everything cool for now. Let's update our stack and see what will happen. Yeah, as you can see, when we created, there are a lot of events happened. So the first thing, the create in progress, these are from the previous, actually, until we reach the create complete. These are from the previous. But here is the new thing, which is the update in progress. As you can see, user initiated update in progress. So if I refresh this, you can see that now we have resource creation initiated, update in progress at the same time. And here we have requested update requires the creation of a new physical resource, hence creating one, as you can see. So if I refresh again, you can see that it is update complete for my instance. And don't forget that we already, as you can see, create complete for the asset security group. The server security group already create complete, as they were in the create in progress, and here the my instance update complete. Then we have the my EIP. Now all of these the logical ID. So if I open the template again, you can see that the logical ID, the my EIP, the my instance. If I scroll down, server security group, asset security group, all of these on the resources, I mean, these are called logical ID. So if I refresh that, you can see that delete in progress for my instance, because here update complete, cleanup in progress here, as you can see. Now, as you can see, delete complete for my instance. And now the test stack update complete. Okay, so far so good. Now let's head to the resources. Now for the resources, we have four resources. The my EIP, this one. Now, as you can see, now it has a physical ID because it has been provisioned. My instance here, these are the my instances, the physical ID. So if I go here to the EC2 instances, to the running instances, you can see now we have a new one and the old one is terminated. So as you can see, we already terminated that and we created a new instance with a new with attached EIP. As you can see, this is the test stack. If I go to the tags, you can see that it has other information, the logical ID, stack name, the stack ID, and so on, as well as for the security group. So if I go down to the security group from here, we have them here, which is the test stack, this one. And if you can see, the group name is test stack as such and so on. And here, which is this one. As well as if I click on this one, you can see if I scroll down to the description, you can see that I have this description, the one I added to the parameter as we defined. So as you can see inside this one, which is the security group description, on the description of this one, when we use it inside as a reference inside the server security group, we referenced the security group description, which is this one from the parameters scope. All right, so far so good. Okay, so the outputs here, we didn't provide any outputs, but the parameter, as you can see, we add this parameter, the security group description, and the value is here, we added it manually. Okay, and if I click on the template, you can see that the template has been updated. So far so good. Now finally, if I click on delete here, I will delete the stack and all the resources inside it. Okay, so I delete it like this. So if I go to the events, you can see that the delete is in progress. It starts with my EIP, my instance, the server asset security group, or the asset security group, and so on until everything is deleted. So if I click on here, delete in progress for the test stack. So far so good. Now again, if you want to try this step by step with me, I already uploaded the template that I worked on here on this lecture as a downloadable content. You can find it, download it, upload it, and try it out. You will not lose anything. It will cost you zero, well, nothing. It will not cost you anything. Okay, I will see you in the next lecture. Now, the CloudFormation parameters. So you can use the optional parameter section to customize your templates. Parameters enable you to input custom values to your template each time you create or update a stack. Now, this is something we already saw, as you can see from here. You can see that we used parameters for the security group description, and we referenced for the group description for this server security group. We referenced the security group description, which is something inside the parameter here, and we put the description, the type, and we entered or typed the value we want, which was the test description we entered. Here, as you can see, this is the official documentation. You can read more about this. There are something I want to mention here, actually. So as you can see, this example declares a parameter named instance type parameter. This parameter lets you specify an Amazon EC2 instance type for the stack to use when you create or update the stack. Note here, the instance type parameter has a default value, which is T2 micro. This value that AWS can use it to provision the stack unless another value is provided. Okay, now here we have the JSON format and the YAML, but in our case, we need the YAML actually, because it is better and easy to read, as we mentioned. So the parameters here, as you can see, the syntax, inside it we put, as you can see, two spaces here. Instance type parameter. The type is string. The default here is T2 micro, as you can see. The allowed values is T2 micro, M1 small, M1 large. The description for this instance type parameter, enter T2, M1, M1 large, M1 small, default is T2 micro. So what is new here is the default is T2 micro, this one, and the allowed values, which is these ones. So if we entered anything other than these, it will not work. As you can see, these only are the allowed values. All right, so far so good. And if we want to reference the parameter within the template, we need to use the ref, which is the reference intrinsic function. And this is something, again, we already saw. As you can see here, if you scroll down, we use that inside this using the reference function. This is the intrinsic functions. We will talk about these in details in a separate lecture. So here, this example, as you can see, we reference the instance parameter for the instance type. Okay, but this time, as you can see, it use another syntax, which is this one. Inside the instance type, we reference this as a key value. But actually, it will work again if you put it on the same line here, I mean. And with using the exclamation mark, shift plus one, inside all on the same line here. But put it the exclamation mark before the ref without using the colon here. Just the same as using this one. As you can see, we have it on the same line without putting it under the tree or under the group description tree. Okay, so it works either way. So here are some of the requirements for the parameter I want to mention. The first thing, you can have maximum of 60 parameters in the AWS CloudFormation template. Each parameter must be given a logical name, also called the logical ID, and this is something we already saw, which must be alphanumeric and unique among all logical names within the template. Each parameter must be accessed a parameter type that is supported by AWS CloudFormation. So you can put the type anything you want. These are must be supported by the AWS. Each parameter must be assigned a value at a runtime for AWS CloudFormation to successfully provision the stack, and the parameters must be declared and referenced from within the same template. So far, so good. And as you can see here, you can reference parameter from the resources and outputs section of the template. The outputs here, this is something we will handle it on a separate lecture, don't worry. Okay, for now, as you can see, this is the syntax, the parameters, here the parameter logical ID, the type must be supported by AWS, and the parameter property, which is value. So here you can read more about more options and more things, and so you can see the important, you can see you read more, depends on what you need. What I want now, if I want to scroll down to see this example, as you can see, basic input parameter. So as you can see, the following example parameter section declare two parameter. The DB port parameter is one of type number with the default value of this one, and the minimum value that can be specified is this, and the maximum value can be this. And the DB port, which is another parameter, PWD, is of type string with no default value, and the no equal property is set to true to prevent describe stack calls such as AWS CloudFormation describe stacks. Okay, now let's scroll down here and have a look. It's better actually than reading out loud. So we have two parameters, the DB port and DB PWD. So for the DB port, the default one is this one. These are the description. The type is number, as you can see, and this is the minimum value and the maximum value. So far, so good. So this is the first parameter, as you can see. The second parameter is DB PWD. No echo is equal true. The database admin account password. This is the admin account password. The type is string. The minimum is 1. The maximum is 41. And these are the allowed pattern, as you can see. You can read more examples, as you can see. But for now, we will stop on this. We already declared that. We already saw how to use parameters. Now, it's up to you. Depends on the architecture, the program, or the infrastructure you are building. You can modify whatever parameter to use it over and over. All right? Now, the CloudFormation resources. The required resources section declares AWS resources that you want to include in the stack, such as Amazon EC2 instances or S3 bucket and so on. Okay, now this is the syntax. As you can see, the resources section consists of the key name resources. The following pseudo template outlines the resources section. So let's see the YAML format. The resources, inside it, then we will put the logical ID, which is something we already saw. The type here, the resource type. And again, the resource type here is something reserved. We cannot put anything. This must be supported by AWS. And the properties, we can put the set of properties depend on the resource type. Okay, now here you can read more from some examples and so on, but we already saw that. So let's have a look here with the AWS resources and property types reference. These are all of the AWS resources that support it currently. Okay, so this is the syntax or the form, service provider, service name, and data type name. So if I open this, so you can see that these are the resources. This is the logical ID, which is my instance. The type is AWS EC2 instance. Okay, so it's this instance, EC2, and it is instance. The properties is like these, okay? So here are all of the resources we have for code. Pipeline, config, EC2, S3, Elastic Load Balancer, Lambda, Route 53, Step Function, a lot of things actually. So for now, let's see EC2, which is something already saw. And here you can see all the resources types regarding the EC2. So we have a customer gateway, VPN route. We have instance, which is something we already saw, internet gateway, network ACL route, VPC, VPN gateway, and so on, okay? Now, all of these you can define and use whatever you want. So if I go to the instance, which is something we already saw. Now, again, now this, I got this from the official documentation, as you can see. So you can just Google it or using any search engine, just all AWS CloudFormation resources, and you will find it on the same, on the first search result. So no big deal, actually. Okay. So here are the syntax for the EC2 instance. For the YAML, let's see the YAML. Here are all the properties we have, the additional info, affinity, block device mapping, CPU options, actually everything in details here, everything. Okay, and we can read more about these actually. So for example, the CPU options, you can see this is the CPU option for the instance, required, no, and the type is CPU option, update requires, as you can see, it is the replacement. Okay, so everything in details you'll find it here. So if you are trying or you are writing your own CloudFormation template for your own company, for your own organization, or the people you are working with, regardless actually, so just head out to the AWS CloudFormation AWS official documentation, and there you can find whatever you want, depends on the criteria you are working on. Okay, thanks for watching. I will see you in the next lecture. All right, now let's start with the mappings. Now, the optional mappings section matches a key to corresponding set of named values. So for example, if you want to set values based on a region, you can create a mapping that uses the region name as a key and contains the values you want to specify for each specific region. And you can use the fn find in map intrinsic function to retrieve values in map. Now, actually, don't confuse of this part, which is the fn with double colons, as you can see. Well, actually, this is the same as replacing the fn double colon with exclamation mark. Okay, so you can put this syntax or with the exclamation marks. It is the same. Here, I think you cannot include parameters, pseudo parameters, or intrinsic function in the mappings section, as you can see, because this must be a hard-coded value. Okay, and actually it is very useful. So let's have an example here. As you can see, this is the syntax, mappings, mapping 01, the key name is value, key 2 name value, key 3 name value. Okay, so let's see some examples. Well, actually it is better. So these are basically mapping. So the following example showing mapping section with map region map. Okay, so which we contain 5 keys that map name value containing async string values, and the keys are region named. Each name value pair is AMI ID for the HVM64 AMI in the region represented by the key. So let's have a look for the YAML language. So you can see mappings, then the region map. For the US East 1, we have this value, this key for this value. So you can see this is the AMI for this HVM64. But if it is inside the US West 1, for the HVM64, this is the AMI. For the EU West 1, for the HVM65, this is the AMI. The AMI ID, I mean. So as you can see, we can use the HVM64 AMI. And you know that the AMI is locked to the region. So AMI in specific region doesn't mean the same AMI in other region. You know that. So by doing a mapping for each region, we make sure that we know all the AMI for all the region for this specific AMI or this specific image, all right, which is the HVM64. Okay, now here are some other examples like mapping with multiple values. So you can see the same thing, but HVM64, which is this AMI, HVM G2, this AMI. This is for US East 1, the same for US West 2, US West 1, US EU West 1, AP Northeast 1, and so on. All right. Here you can retain a value from a mapping by using this thing, which is the find in map intrinsic function. As you can see, by using this format or using the exclamation mark, it is the same again. So let's have a look on the YAML. So here, format version, the mapping, region mapping, as you can see, we use that until we reach, as you can see, we declare that in the mappings in the region map. And here in the resources, we use the inside the properties, the image ID find in map. As you can see, we use this time we use the exclamation mark. As you can see, find in map, the region map, and reference from the AWS region HVM64. So please find the HVM64 inside the AWS region that we are in regarding from the region map. So again, from region map, which is this one, please find the HVM64, either this one, sorry, either this one, or this one, or this one, or this one, or this one. Depends on the region we are currently in, which is using the ref AWS region, as you can see. So depends on the region we in, we will take the image AMI or the AMI ID depends. So if we are inside the US East 1, for example, and we want HVM64, so this is the HVM64, and this is the AMI ID inside the region map. So we will put this image ID instead of that. So the image ID will be this one, if we assume that we are in the US East 1. And the instance type is M1 small, as you can see. Here are another examples like input parameter, find in map. So here the YAML, as you can see, you can read more about it. Actually, it is, the documentation is very rich, depends on your criteria and whatever you want. Okay, thanks for watching. Now the CloudFormation outputs. Now the optional output section declares output values that you can import into other stacks. So this is to create a cross stack references and return in response to describe stack calls or view on the CloudFormation console. So for example, you can output the S3 bucket name for a stack to make the bucket easier to find. But here are some important note I want to mention, so that CloudFormation doesn't redact or obfuscate any information you include in the output section. So we strongly recommend that you do not use this section to output sensitive information such as password or secrets. So don't use that to put sensitive information. That's for sure, okay? So here, this is the syntax, as you can see, the outputs. Then you put your logical ID. Here are some of the description, the value to return, and you can export whatever value to export, okay? So here you can read more about the output fields. As you can see, here are some of the notes for the export. So for each AWS account, export name must be unique within the region. You cannot create cross-stack reference across regions. You can use the intrinsic function import value to import only values that have been exported within the same region. And for outputs, the value of the name property of an export cannot use reference or get attribute that depend on a resource. And you cannot delete stack if another stack reference of its output. You cannot modify or remove an output value that is referenced by another stack. Okay, so let's see this example. Okay, actually, the outputs, backup load balancer DNS name. This is the description, which is the DNS name of the backup load balancer. The value, we will get the attribute backup load balancer.dns name. The condition, create prod resources, whatever. The condition, we will talk about it later on. The instance ID here, you can see that the description, the instance ID, the value reference, the EC2 instance, which is something from other stack, okay? So let's have a cross stack output actually. So you can see that in the following examples, the output named stack VPC retained the ID of a VPC and then export the value of cross stack references with the name VPC ID append to the stack's name. So here an example, outputs, stack VPC, description, here the ID of the VPC, and the value, as you can see, my VPC. As you can see, we got my VPC, and we export that as you can see, we use the substitution intrinsic function, and we use the AWS stack name, which is the name of the stack, with the VPC ID. As you can see, the VPC ID. So we export that, the stack VPC, we export it. All of this information and these things, we export it as this name, actually, and we will import it on another stack. We just put from export instead of export, we will use import, and we put the name here we receive from there, okay? As simple as that. Well, actually, this is just a theory, so you can see that here there is another thing. So here you can see that we use the FN import value, and the value we got the network stack name security group ID. This is some value from other stack template. And you can see here are the supported functions we can use inside the import value. The base 64, find map, if, join, select, split, sub, reference, and so on. Alright. This is just was a theory lecture actually. We don't have any hands-on on that, but it's no big deal actually. But you need to use the import and the export value inside the output name in your template to get across stack values, so to exchange information or values between two different stacks. So after you create it and implement that into your template and run it on your stack, you can find that inside your outputs there are some outputs there. So this is just an example. As you can see, this is a photo, so you can find everything here inside the output tab we just saw inside the stack interface. Then we can use the key depends on the value and so on, with using import and export depends on what your needs. Okay, now CloudFormation conditions. Now the optional conditions section contains statement that define the circumstances under which entries are created or confirmed. So for example, you can create a condition and then associate it with a resource or the output, so that AWS CloudFormation only creates the resource or output if the condition is true. So as you can see here, you might condition you want to reuse template that you can create resource in different contexts, such as test environment versus production environment, the default regions, specific regions, and so on. Okay, well, actually it's better if we go to the examples, but for that, here are some important notes. During stat update, you cannot update conditions by themselves. You can update conditions only when you include changes that add, modify, or add all the resources. Okay, so here are some of the, or here the syntax, the conditions. Then you put your logical ID, the intrinsic function, which are the and equals if not or. All right, okay, so here are some examples using the YAML. As you can see, AWS template format version. The mappings that with the region map and depends on the region, all of that. Okay, now the parameters here, the env type, the description environment type, the default is test, the type here is string, and the allowed values either prod or test, and the constraint description, you must specify prod or test. So this is something we already saw as hands-on, the parameter when we add and typed our parameter manually when we created or even updated our stack actually. So when you update or create a stack, you provide the parameter, which is the inf type, either it is test or prod. And if you didn't specify anything, it will be test. Okay, now let's scroll down. Here we will use the conditions. So create prod resource. If it is equal to, as you can see here, reference, inf type, prod. So if the create prod resources, if the environment is equal to prod from the inf type here, so if the environment is prod, then we will create a prod resources, and then we will use that inside all the resources we want. Okay, let's have a look actually. So here's the first resource, the EC2 instance. Here the image find in map, whatever the mount point, as you can see. So the type is volume attachment. We want to attach this volume, whatever, some volume. The condition here to create prod resources. So if we specified manually, remember when we specified manually the parameter manually, so here we will specify, if we specified the parameter, the inf type, as a prod, then we can attach this volume, as you can see, because we specified the condition to be create prod resources. And if you go up here to the conditions, to the create prod resources, the create prod resources is equal to type, is equals. So which means that if the inf type is prod or equal prods, as you can see, equal prod, so inf type equal prods, then yes, go and create prod resources. So the condition must be true. If you specify it as a prod, your condition as a prod, your inf type, I mean your parameter, then you can create and attach the volume. Here are the properties, instances ID, volume ID, and so on. Let's scroll down again. Here you can see that we have a new volume. Now we will create a new volume for this EC2 instance. The type is volume, and we have again a condition. So, and the condition is create prod resources. So the condition is create prod resources. We will go up to the conditions, to the create prod resources, which is this one. If the inf type equal to the prod, but don't forget to put the reference inf type, because the inf type here is parameter, as you can see the inf type is inside the parameter. So we referenced the inf type. If the inf type is equal to prod, and again we entered or we specify that manually, don't forget that. If it is equal to prod, then everything is good. Your condition must be okay or equal. Yes, it is equal, which means this is true. So the condition is true, so everything working fine. We can create a new volume, and the size is 100 gigabyte, availability zone, get the attribute from this as availability zones. And here the outputs, the volume ID for the outputs, and the condition. Again, to output that, so we can use it on another stack for cross region and cross stacks. If the condition create broad resources, then yes, the value reference new volume, which is this one, as you can see. We put it as outputs, so we can export it, we can import it as much as we can for this stack. Okay, so far so good. All right, thanks for watching. I will see you in the next lecture. Now for the intrinsic functions. Now we already saw some of the intrinsic functions. So as you can see, AWS CloudFormation provides several built-in functions that help you manage your stacks. And you can use the intrinsic function in your template to assign values to properties that are not available until runtime, as you can see. So you can use intrinsic functions only in specific part of a template. Currently, you can use intrinsic function in resource properties, outputs, metadata attributes, and update policy attributes. As you can see, you can use it to conditionally create stack resources. So here are the intrinsic functions, like base64, CIDR, condition functions. So if we have look here, like the and, equals, if, not, or, and all of those. Find in map, get attributes, get AZs, which is the availability zones. Import value, join, select, split, sub, transform, reference. Okay, now you can use them, depends on what you need. Okay, well, this was actually a short lecture. Okay, thanks for watching. I will see you in the next lecture. All right, now let's start with the CloudFormation user data. Okay, now the user data is something we already saw when we launched our instances. So when you launch your instance and you want to run specific commands, for example, you can put whatever you want as a user data. And I assume that this is something you already saw actually and used. So this is just an example of the user data, as you can see here. So for example, you want yum update dash y and you want to install the Apache server. You want to make the user mode as Apache, change the owner of this var www directory and so on. There are a lot of commands actually. Then put the PHP here, a simple PHP command inside the PHP info.php. So you go to the php.info using your public IP address. Now this is just a simple example. Now one thing I want to mention is the user data output will be here. Var log cloud init dash output dot log. So all the output of the user data commands will be here. Okay, now and this is something we will right away. Okay, so don't worry. Okay, now this is regarding the EC2. Now regarding the CloudFormation, it is just the same, but we implement that as a code inside our template. Okay, so let's have a look here. So here, as you can see, the userdata.yaml file. Don't worry, I already upload this file. You can find it as a downloadable content, okay, in this section. Sorry, in this lecture. Okay, now here we put a parameters, but this time as SSH key. You can so here you need to have at least a key pair as such for connecting that already created. So you can type its name here and next. Okay, so for the resources, it is the instance, as you can see, just a simple instance T2 micro, and the key name, as you can see, now we used the key name and we referenced the SSH key, which is the something we provide in the parameters. And here the security group for the SSH security group, okay, which is something I think we already saw that, which is CID allowed from everywhere and 80 allowed from everywhere. Okay, now what is new here is the user data, as you can see here. So user data here, if you notice, it is inside the properties for this instance. So the user data for this instance will be like this. We used the intrinsic function base64 because the user data must be base64 after all, okay? Must be encoded using the base64. Either you encode it and put the encoded here, the base64 encode here, or you can use the intrinsic function, which is the fn base64, okay? Now we will use the vertical pipe here, so you can put multi-lines, okay? So this used actually to provide a multi-line, okay? So bin bash dash xe, which means that execute everything, show us the execution, and exit if there are any errors. You can read more about it. Yum update dash y, yum install the httpd, which is the Apache, start it, enable it, so on startup, it will run on startup, and echo hello world from user data, and we will put it on the var windex.html, okay? This is just a simple user data, actually. We want to install Apache, and then we put a simple hello world inside it. Okay, now let's see the hands-on. Here we will create a new stack. The template is ready. We want to upload it. We will choose the userdata.yaml. Next, here the stack name, user data stack, or put any name you want. But now we have a parameter, which is the SSH key. As you can see, you can choose. I have a lot of SSH key pairs. I will choose this. It's okay, just create one if you don't have. Yeah, actually I forget, without underscore must be dashes like this. The name, let's put name and put test stack. It's okay, no IAM role, no policy, no nothing. Okay, so go next, and as you can see, we are ready. All right, now let's create the stack. All right, now the stack create in progress. So let's wait a little bit until it is created successfully. All right, everything is created successfully. As you can see, the state complete for the user data stack, the my instance, the SSH security group, and so on. All right, now if I have a look on the resources, you can see that we have this instance. Now if I go to it like this, now here is the stack we want now, and it has a public IP address. So if I scroll down, you can see the key pair name is TT, as you can see. So everything is right. The tags here, you can see that it has the cloud, the stack ID, the stack name, the logical ID. And for the security, you can see that we have everything allowed from port 80 and port 22. As you can see, this is the security group. All right, now let's connect to it and check that first. And I will connect using the browser, actually. All right. So if I go to cat var log cloud init dash output dot log, you can see that we have all the information here. So as you can see, cleanup, download this, download this. As you can see, we downloaded and installed Apache. And as you can see, there are other packages that have been downloaded. You can see that we have other file, which is the cloud init logs. And here you can see that if you want to debug more, okay? Now, if I take the public IP address and I want to check, now it should give us hello world from user data. So everything is working fine. Now, as you can see in this lecture, you learned how to use user data in your template, in your CloudFormation template, and you can update that, you can use that as much as you want, okay? All right, I will see you in the next lecture. All right, now for the CloudFormation CFN init. Well, the CFN init is the same as user data, but CFN init is used when your user data or your running commands are very complex, or let's say they are complex somehow. All right, as you can see, the CFN init helper script reads template metadata from the AWS CloudFormation init key and asks accordingly to fetch and parse metadata from AWS CloudFormation, install packages, write files to disk, enable or disable, start or stop services. All right, so far so good. So let's have a real quick example here. So as you can see this example, you can install specific things, do specific things, and so on, okay? Now just have a look on the syntax here. You can see that it is the same. We use user data and we use 64, okay. Now let's start with the hands-on. Actually, I already uploaded a file which is called CFN init. As you can see, now this is real life. Actually, it is better than that example. So you can see that here, the same. We have the parameter for the key pair, the instances, the resources, which is for the resources, the instance, and it is the same. This is AMI, T2 micro, the SSH key for the security group. But now for the user data, now it is somehow different, okay? So if you have a look here for the user data, this time we used sub, as you can see. So if I return here, you can see that in the user data, for the user data YAML, in the user data we use a base64 and we put the vertical pipe and we put all the scripts, all the commands we want, all the bash commands. But here we use the sub intrinsic function, and we use the vertical pipeline, and here we put bash for XE. So then we yum update dash y AWS CFN bootstrap. So this to get the latest CloudFormation packages. And then we will start the CFN init script or utility. So you can see opt AWS bin CFN init dash S for the AWS stack ID. This is the stack ID dash R for this instance, for the logical ID, as you can see. For the region that the stack in, and if there are some errors, so we will put this error, exit failed to run CFN init, okay? So if we have, or if we face any error, okay? So far so good, right? It is just the user data, we use 64, but this time we use sub with the vertical pipe, not just the vertical pipe, okay? Okay. Now here, the new things actually is, which is the metadata, okay? So you can see that. But as you can see, this is not inside the properties. This is inside the instance at the same level of type or properties. As you can see, the metadata is inside the my instance here. As you can see, the metadata is inside it. Okay. But the user data is inside the properties for the instance. Okay. And the metadata here, as we talked about. So the metadata here is inside the my instance, and this, as you can see, we have comment for this metadata. We want to install a simple Apache HTTP page. So AWS CloudFormation init. Actually, these are from the official documentation. This is from the AWS. They have its own format. Okay, this is the format. So AWS CloudFormation init. Config, we want to put a packages or use specific packages. And for these packages, we want to install using yum packages. And the name of the package is httpd, which is the Apache server. And then we have this files. As you can see, the files here is inside the config. Again, the packages is inside the config, and we have yum httpd. And the files is inside the config. As you can see, two spaces here. 1, 2, okay? The same for this. 1, 2, as you can see. The files inside the config, okay? And for the file, this file, the var www.html index.html, the content of it will be like this. Hello world from EC2 instance. This was created using CFN init, okay? And you, as you can see, this is h1, and this is a paragraph, all right? And the mode for this file will be like this. Then we will use the commands, and again, the commands inside is inside the config, the same level as files, the same levels as packages. And the command is hello world, as you can see, and command echo hello world, all right? And then the services, and again, the services on the same level as files, as commands, as packages, which is inside the config. Then we have sysv init, httpd enabled true, ensure running true, okay? So we will make sure that the httpd Apache server is running correctly, okay? And again, this is the same security group, configuration, and so on. Okay, now as you can see, this is, I know we have written more things, more lines, and the YAML file now is bigger than the first one, which is this one. But actually, this is, if you have a complex setup, or you have a lot of things you need to handle, and you don't need to handle them in a simple way, okay? Because user data actually is a simple, but CFN init is more powerful actually. And in the next lecture, we will talk about the CFN wait and signal and condition, which is something very important. And actually, here's come the powerful of using CFN init over user data. But for now, keep with me. Now let's run this actually. Again, the CFN init YAML file, I already uploaded. You can find it and download it as a downloadable content, and if you want to practice with me step by step, and actually I recommend. Okay, so let's create a stack, use a template, CFN init, next, the SSH key, I will use TT here, the name is test-name-stack, next, put anything for the tags, permission, the stack policy is the same, next, now as you can see, everything is working fine, let's create the stack. Now let's wait a little bit until it is created successfully. Okay, now as you can see, everything create complete. Now if I head to the resources, to the my instance, as you can see, then I want to connect to it actually. So if I copy the public IP address and put it here, let's see, you can see that we have everything as we expected, which is hello world from EC2 instances as a h1 tag, and this was created using CFN, which as a paragraph tag. Okay, so everything working fine. Now let's connect to it actually and see inside it. Let's have a look on the logs and see what have been done. So if I go to cat var log cloud init dash output dot log, you can see that we already have downloaded the AWS CFN bootstrap, which is something we already saw here, as you can see. Yum update dash YCFN bootstrap. And if I scroll up a little, you can see that we have downloaded all the packages needed for the HTTPD, which is the Apache server. All right, so far so good. Now in the next lecture, we will talk about the CFN wait, how to use CFN init with the wait condition and a CFN signal. And this is actually something very powerful, and it is used to make sure that your instances that are configured correctly. So how did we assume that this worked fine or worked 100%? We didn't. We just assume it is working, but we didn't make sure it is running as expected. So in the next lecture, we will learn that. Okay, I will see you there. All right, now the CloudFormation CFN signal. Now, as you can see, the CFN signal helper script signals AWS CloudFormation to indicate whether Amazon EC2 instances have been successfully created or updated. Okay, or if you install and configure software application in your instances. So you can signal AWS CloudFormation when those software applications are ready, okay? So you will use CFN signal with the wait condition with the creation policy. As you can see, here are some of the examples if you check the official documentation, but don't worry about that. Actually, I already upload a script, as you can see, which is the CFN signal.yaml. You can find it as a downloadable content. As you can see, the CFN signal.yaml, the same thing. As you can see, the parameters, the resources, the same thing. But here, inside the user data, we have the after we install or update our AWS CFN Bootstrap, after we run the CFN init utility here, we run the CFN signal as well, and we execute the $?? Here, and this is a bash script actually, or this is a bash, which means that the previous command, did it run correctly or did it run wrong? Okay, so if it did run correctly, we will go to this stack ID, to the resource sample wait condition, and this is something we will see it here, and for the region, for the current region for the stack. Okay, so we will put, or we will send this signal to the sample wait condition, which is this one. All right, and we will send either if it is run correctly or if it is run wrong. So as you can see, this command, which is the CFN init, if it is run correctly, we will send that to the sample wait condition. Yes, it is run correctly. If it is run wrong, we will send that to the sample wait condition. It is run wrong. Okay. Now again, I already uploaded this file as downloadable content. You can find it, download it, and try that step by step. Okay. So this is the same actually from the previous. But for the sample wait condition, now as you can see, we used the creation policy and the resource signal here. We put a timeout, we will wait 2 minutes, and the count, as you can see, is one, so we will receive one signal. And here, as you can see, the type is AWS CloudFormation wait condition. Okay, so we will wait 2 minutes. If after two minutes nothing received, we will make there is a problem happening, or CloudFormation will declare that there is something wrong. Okay. Now let's test that right away. Actually, here, create a stack, upload a template file, CFN signal this time. Next, the stack name, anything, test stack. The key, I will use DTE like this, and whatever tags you want. Permission, no permission, or nothing. Okay, just click next and create the stack. So if I refresh here, as you can see, it is create in progress. Let's wait a little bit. You can see that we have a sample wait condition that create on in progress. Again, sample wait condition, but this resource created initiated. Now let's have a look here for the SSH security group created successfully. The instance create in progress resource creation initiated. Now you can see that the instance create complete. Now you can see that this stack is complete, as you can see. So if you notice here, you can see that at 4:58, but the first thing at 4:56. So let's see the sample wait here at 4:56. And here at 4:58, as you can see, we waited 2 minutes until everything, then we give it, as you can see, the wait condition here. Yeah, actually, the sample wait condition, as you can see, we received the signal, and the sample wait condition is create complete, which means that everything is working fine. Okay, so this means that we made sure that the EC2 instances are configured correctly 100%. No errors, nothing wrong happened, and so on. Okay, by that, you can guarantee your servers are running fine without any issues or any problem. And you can see, you can check the resources as well as the parameters, which is the SSH key we implement. All right, thanks for watching. I will see you in the next lecture. All right, now let's start with the rollback. So rollback, actually as simple as that. If we face any problem or any error, we will roll back, we will return to the previous version or previous template, all right? And we will delete every resource in the current stack. But sometimes we need for the rollback to be disabled, so we can investigate as such into the instances, for example, and investigate why there is error on something. So if we go to here and I choose next, just type anything, actually, I'm just showing you. And you scroll down, you can see that inside the stack creation options, here is the rollback on failure. So specify whether the stack should be rollback if stack creation fails. So either it is enabled or disabled. And as well as you can type the timeout before stack creation times out, okay? And here you can put the termination protection as well. So if we face any failure, we will just roll back. Or if we face any failure, no, don't roll back, don't delete anything, don't delete the created resources. We want to search into them and investigate why this happened. It is this as simple as that, actually, okay? All right, now working with nested stacks. Now, nested stacks are stacks created as part of other stacks. So you can create a nested stack within another stack by using the AWS CloudFormation stack resource, all right? So as you can see, as they describe, if your infrastructure is grows, common pattern can emerge in which you declare same component in multiple templates. So you don't need to use that over and over, okay? Actually, this is bad practice, but the best practice is to use a nested stack. So as you can see this example, assume that you have a load balancer configuration that you use most of your stacks. Instead of copying and pasting the same configuration into your templates over and over, you can just create a dedicated template for the load balancer. Then you can just use the resource to reference that template from within other templates. And this is the best practice, all right? So let's see this diagram. Well, actually, I intended using the AWS configuration because I want you to get used to it. So you can see that we have all the information in the official documentation. So for example here, let's say this example, this diagram. So this is the stack A, as you can see, is the root of all other stacks, nested stacks in hierarchy. This is the green one, which is A. So stack B, stack A is both parent stack as well as the root stack. So as you can see, A, we have stack B. So stack B is parent for the stack C. And as you can see, the green one is the root stack. The gray one is the nested stack. And this blue line is the parent, which means C stack is parent to D stack. And B stack is parent to C stack, as well as A for B. And the orange line, you can see this means the root. So with what is the root for D? The root for D is the A stack. And the root for C and B as well is the A stack. All right, so you can see here for stack D, stack C is the parent stack, while for stack C, stack B is the parent stack, as I told you, all right? So here is, as you can see, this is considered a best practice, actually, okay? Now you can read more, actually, but I already prepared a template and I upload it as a downloadable content. You can see this. Now, actually, I got this from the official documentation, to be honest. So you can see that we have the parameters here. The same thing with the SSH key there. Now for the resources, now this time we have the my stack, the logical ID, and the type is CloudFormation stack, as you can see. The properties is the template URL. Now you can see this is the template URL. Now this is I got it from the ready templates provided by AWS. You can see this is the LAMP single instance. So if I copy and paste that actually here, you can see this is the template cloud and the description and have the parameters, the DB name, and a lot of things. Actually, it is very huge. But for this, the outputs, you can see we have website URL, the description URL for a newly created LAMP stack, the value, join HTTP with the GET attribute of web server instance, public DNS name, as you can see. All right, so let's have another look again. So for the parameters for this stack, we have key name, and reference the key name, which is the SSH parameter. So as you can see, these parameters are exclusive for this stack, all right? So for this stack, these parameters are only for this stack, but this parameter for everyone or for everything in the template, all right? So the key name, we will get it as a reference from the SSH parameter, key for up here, up there, the DB name, the DB user, DB password, the DB root password, instance type the T2 micro, and SSH location from anywhere to anywhere, as you can see, or from anywhere. And the outputs here, we get a stack reference where the value from my stack here, the, for the value, and the output from nested stack, as you can see, we use this now. And the value will get attribute from my stack, which is this one, outputs dot website URL. That's something that I show you here from the URL. It's copy and paste it again. As you can see, the website, the URL, and the value, as you can see. All right. So far, so good. All right. Now let's upload it and see what this. Again, I already uploaded this file for you as a downloadable content if you want to practice step by step. Okay. Now let's create a stack here. Now let's upload a template. Its name is nested stack.yaml. The stack name is test. The SSH key is TT, as you can see. Next. Here, if you want to enable or disable rollback on failure, let's enable it or let's disable it as you wish. Next. Now you will see now something new here, which is the capabilities. So you can see the following resource require capabilities, as you can see, CloudFormation stack. This template contains IAM resources. Check that you want to create each of these resources. As you can see, I acknowledge that AWS CloudFormation might create IAM resources with custom names. I acknowledge that AWS CloudFormation might require the following capability auto expand, as you can see. So you need to make sure, because we used a nested stacks here. So this will just give you a warning you need to be aware of. That's it. So let's create the stack. So you can see, let's have a little, let's wait a little until it is created and we will have a look. Okay, now you will see that the stack we named test that have been created completely. Okay, now if I return to the stacks, you can see that now we have two stacks actually. For the stack we created, this one, and we include and we upload the template. And we have the nested stack, and if you can see, we have a nested tag here actually, and this is a cloud, this is the description for it, and this is the one that we included as a stack or as a nested stack. So you can see that we have all the events here, as you can see, the resources, the outputs. You can see the outputs, we have the website URL. So if I click on it, you can see that we have the php.info file, as well as the parameters, and his here is the template, as you can see, the template, the one that we provide as a nested. But here on the test, if I click on the template, you can see that we have the template and we have this as a stack. As you can see, the type is stack on inside the resources and use its own parameters. All right. One last thing. If you deleted the test stack, the stack you created or the root stack, the all of the nested stack will be deleted, as you can see. So this one have been deleted. And if I tried to delete the nested stack, it will warn me that no, you need to delete the root stack, or you need to go to the root stack, and it will give you some warning. All right, thanks for watching. All right, now let's start with the CloudFormation change sets. Well, actually, when you need to update a stack, understanding how your changes will affect your running resources before you implement them, as you can see, before you implement them, can help you update stacks with confidence. So change sets here allow you to preview how to propose changes to a stack that might impact your running resources. So for example, whether your changes will delete or replace any critical resources, AWS CloudFormation makes the changes to your stack only when you decide to execute the change set, allowing you to decide whether to proceed with your proposed changes or explore other changes. So let's scroll down here. As you can see, we have this diagram, and this is from the official documentation of AWS. Now, the first thing, this is the origin stack. You need to create or modify it. You just create a change set. So after you create a change set, these are the change sets. For example, you can view the change set. So you can view them. I will replace this for this, and I will add more, delete more, and so on. Now, if you are not satisfied, you can, as you can see, this is the third, create additional change sets until you are satisfied. Then you can see the fourth step here, execute the change set, and you will update your stack. Okay. Okay. Now let's have a real quick now. Okay. I will create a stack, and the stack will be a simple EC2 actually. This one actually, the one that we used the first on the from the first lecture, as you can see, just a simple EC2 server or instance with this AMI ID and on the North Virginia with T2 micro. Okay, and I want to make a change set using EC2 with SG and EIB, the one that we used when we updated our stack. Okay, so this one's okay. All right, so the first thing I will make an EC2 instances. Simple, all right, simple one. The stack name is simple stack. Next, you can just put anything, we don't need any. Let's go next, and then we create the stack. Now let's wait until it is created. All right, now the simple stack has been created completely. Now you will go to the change set from here and you will create a change set. Okay, so here we will use the current template or edit the template in designer or replace the current template, but we want to replace it with the EC2 with SG and EIB YAML file. Okay, actually we used this file when we updated our stack after we created it. Now you may ask me, but what is the difference actually between the update and the change set? Well, actually we already talked about this. The update will update immediately without warning you or anything. But the change set will give you what will be updated, what we will do, until you are satisfied, then you can execute it. Now we will see right away. So from here, as you can see, we will go to the next, the description, anything. It's okay, anything, it's no big deal. The IAM role, nothing here. Let's click next. And you can see, if I scroll down, everything is working fine. Create the change set. Here is the change set name and the change set description. Let's create a change set for now. This is just a test. As you can see, the status create pending. Let's wait until it is complete. Yeah, as you can see, the status create complete here. The execution status is available. Now, if I scroll down, you can see that the changes, these all of the changes I have. I added my EIB, Elastic IP address. As you can see, the source type is Elastic IP address. I modified my instance with this physical ID to something else, the replacement, which means true. I added another, or I added this security group and I added this security group. Now this is something we already saw actually on the update lecture actually, but the difference again, it is we cannot apply these haven't been applied actually. These updates or these changes haven't been applied yet. It will be applied until I press the execute button. So if I am satisfied, yeah, everything, it's okay. Everything is as I wish. So I can execute now. Now, as you can see, it has been executed. Now let's wait until it is updated for the simple stack. That one we created with the simple EC2 instance. Now, as you can see, the create update in progress, create in progress. The such security has been created, the server security group has been created, my instance has been created, updated, completed, as you can see, my EIP create in progress, now the my EIP create complete, and you can see that the simple stack update complete cleanup in progress, as you can see, my instance delete in progress, which is the older one, because we already replaced it, as we saw on the changes tab. Now you can see that my instance delete complete and the simple stack updated complete. So if I go to the resources here, yeah, you can see that we have my EIB, the instance ID, and with the physical ID, as you can see, the status, everything is complete 100%, and then we have everything as expected. Now for these two YAML files, I already upload them actually on the lecture that we created the simple EC2 and the lecture that we updated the EC2 with security group and these resources. So I think I will not upload them over and over on this lecture. All right, so you can just download them from those lectures because actually they are the same. All right, okay, I will see you in the next lecture. Now for the depends on attribute. So you can use the depends on attribute to specify that creation of a specific resource follows another. So when you add a depends attribute to a resource, that resource is created only after the creation of the resource specified in the depends on attributes. All right, so you cannot create anything until that we depends on is created. Okay, now let's have a look. Actually, there are a lot of examples here, but I already upload one here. Yeah, which is the depends on YAML file, as you can see. So here are some of the mappings, depends on the region and the AMI for that region, and the resources we have EC2 instance. But you can see that, yeah, and the image ID, as you can see, we are taking this, depends on the region we are in. Now you can see that we have the attributes depends on, and as you can see, it is depends on the MyDB, the logical ID inside the resources, as you can see, which is MyDB. So MyDB here will create DB RDS instance. It is 5 giga, T2 micro, MySQL, the engine 5.7. This is the username. This is the password, and the deletion policy is delete. So it will be deleted when we delete it. So we will not have it as a snapshot or anything. Okay. So we will not create EC2 instance, this instance, we will not create it until we make sure that the MySQL or the MyDB is created successfully. So until it is created successfully, then finally we can create the EC2 instance. As simple as that. All right. So it depends on the MyDB. So don't create EC2 instance until the MyDB, these things, are created successfully. Then I can start creating this resource, which is the EC2 instance. All right. Well, actually, I will not handle that as a hands-on, because you can just upload the stack and try it out. Actually, you can see that it is working. I tested it out, actually, as I took that actually from the official documentation from AWS with some modification. So you can see that we can use the depends on with a lot of use cases. All right, thanks for watching. All right, now for the drift detection. So actually on our stack, we can detect any drift that happened to the stacks. So performing a drift detection operation on a stack determines whether the stack has drifted from its expected template configuration and returns detailed information about the drift status of each resource in the stack. So these are the steps, actually, if you follow them from the official documentation, but we will have our own. So let's create a stack and let's upload a stack. We will use the drift.yaml file, as you can see, and this file we will create two security group, 22 and 80. Actually, I got this from the official documentation. The VPC ID, choose any VPC you have, and the stack name, test, anything, click next, and just click next. Let's create the stack. Let's wait until it is created. Everything is created successfully. Now I will go to the resources, and I will go to the SSH security group to make sure that we have everything. So you can see that, yeah, we have two security group, the test SSH security group, and we have the test HTTP security groups. All right, so far so good. So here from the resource or from the test stack console interface, so you can see that we have a stack actions. So if I click here, you can see that we have the view drift result or detect drift. Okay, so first thing, I will click on detect drift. So by that, I will detect if there are any drift happens to the stack from its expected template. Okay, now detect a drift. You can see that drift detection initiated for this stack ID. And if I click on view drift result, you can see that the drift status is in sync, and the last drift check is this time. So the resources drift status, as you can see, for the HTTP and the SSH security, the resources on this stack, they are in sync, which means they have not been drifted at all. Okay, but if I go, for example, to the HTTP security group, and I edited the inbound, for example, and I added a new rule. So let's add 8080, or let's add 9000, for example, and anywhere, for example, and I click on save. So now it should give us there is something wrong, right? Because I edit that manually, and this is a bad practice, actually. So if I detect, click on the detect the stack drift again, it will initiate another drift detection for the stack ID. And if you can see now, and I refresh, you will see that the drift status is drifted now, and we can see that which are the resources that have been drifted. And we, yes, the one that drifted or modified, as you can see, is this one, the HTTP, that one that we saw, actually. If I click on it, you can see that we can detect drift for resource or view drift details. So you can just choose the resources you want to detect the drift for. Okay, so you, for example, you have 100 server, for example, you don't need to check them all or whatever, you just need to check three of them. Okay, you can just select them and detect the drift for this, for these resources. All right, but in our case we have this security group and we can see the view drift details, and you can see all the details we have. So the differences, as you can see, the change is add, we added two security group ingress or inbound, as you can see, the from anywhere to the 9000 TCP port, and from this TCP port actually on 9000 as well. Okay, so you can see the expected is like this, but the actual is like this. So this is the difference, and actually this is something very handy and can be used a lot to automate things, to detect failures, to detect manual modifications, and so on. Okay, thanks for watching.